history class. This was inspired by our fundraiser that we're doing, raising money for the Black Arts Future Fund, as well as iDay. And we wanted to talk a little bit about why art matters. So art isn't like our STEM subjects where it's something you learn now and you can use it later on in the future when it is applicable to your profession. Art is so slept upon because people don't realize art is the past, art is the present, and art is the future. Artists throughout history have been used to record what's going on, whether there's a revolution going on, whether there's some kind of injustice, disparities, whether things are wonderful, what the landscape looks like. So art is basically history, but history in a way that everyone can understand. So today I'm actually going to be talking about music history, and obviously since I am Black and we never learn about what Black people do, we're going to talk about Black people in music history, how Black people were involved in the punk rock movement, in blues, jazz, rock and roll, hip hop, country music. And we're just going to cover a bunch of different composers and what the origin of music is. As a disclaimer, I'm not necessarily going to say who invented certain styles of music, because music is kind of like a conglomerate where there was inspiration from one type of music and that was brought, you know, to give ideas and to give life to a different genre of music. So as you listen, I'm hoping that this video will be both informative as to the history of music as it pertains to Black people, as well as how important art is and why art needs to be funded, why artists need to be supported, and why art is a practice that needs to be perpetuated through the future. Let's talk about why music is so popular. Music is able to span between generations, it's able to span across racial lines, and music is just a way that people are able to connect because you get to understand that you all share a specific experience. Like, you ever listen to a love song or a song about heartbreak and you feel that song and you feel seen, you feel heard by that artist, and you're just like, wow, I thought I was the only one going through this, but clearly there's other people because it's right here in this music. So I asked last week on my Instagram polls or my questions what music means to people and why it's so important, and people said music is an escape at times and is relatable. Other people said it helps us express our own emotions and feelings. Sometimes you don't even know what you're feeling or how to say it, but then sometimes you might find that perfect song. Stevie Wonder said that music is a world within itself with a language all can understand. And then someone else said, music is immersive. Nothing can bring back a memory like music. So maybe you might hear a song and you remember exactly where you were or what you were doing, and that is the power of music. But when we talk about people who are like the greats in music, who comes to mind? Is it maybe Elvis Presley? Is it Ray Charles? Is it Selena? Depending on which genre you like, you might be able to find that Black people have had a hand in all of that. And I'm not saying Black people invented everything and we own everything, but I am trying to bring back the history that was lost, where Black people never received the proper accolades, or they never received the proper recognition for the music that they have contributed. Okay, so we're going to talk about first traditional African music. I'm African, so everything I do is going to start with Africa. Everything is going to have some kind of African spice to it, and that's the power of someone telling their truth and their history. So when you look at textbooks written by European men and you wonder why everything's European, they're seeing the world through their eyes. So it's about time a Black person, an African person, started showing the world through their eyes. So traditional African music was created. It was a way to communicate and express yourself. You had the African drums that symbolized you were going to war. You had other types of music that symbolized marriage or a rite of passage into adulthood. As slaves came to America, they also brought their African music to America. And they used instruments to communicate, which was taken away by their masters. So the slaves actually started to use their bodies and their voices to make music. In the 17th century, Negro spirituals were derived from African music and a little bit of what they believed to be church music. So Negro spirituals were the only way to express how the slaves felt because they couldn't say it outwardly or else they risked punishment. When the slaves wrote about their experiences as slaves in America in songs of longing for freedom, sadness, suffering, and protested against slavery. Example is Go Down Moses. So, should I sing it? It's like, go down Moses, way down in Egypt land, tell old Pharaoh to let my people go. That was in the 17th century. Now you have the 1860s to the American Civil War, where you had the chain gang era. People were working in the background as they sang. So that's like the songs where you hear, it could be a Negro spiritual, but you also heard like chains in the background. You heard hammers hitting or mallets or whatever they used back then. From 1895 to 1918, you had ragtime. A famous composer was Scott Joplin. As blacks started to gain popularity for music, coon songs emerged, where white men were using blackface and performed popular songs by black artists, usually mocking them. Examples are Al Jolson, Plantation Act. From the 1920s to the 1930s, you had blues, and some famous composers are Robert Johnson, B.B. King, Leadbelly. In 1930s and 40s, you had jazz and swing. Examples of composers are Ella Fitzgerald, Duke Ellington, and Louis Armstrong. The jazz and the swing was an anti-bourgeoisie movement that was rebellious because it associated with drugs and interracial coupling. So you couldn't have interracial coupling because, reminder, this is the 1930s and 1940s, and this was when blacks and whites started commingling, but interracial marriage wasn't legalized until about the 1950s. Now you have your 1940s and 1950s where R&B was popular. You had Ray Charles, you had The Court. Then came the 50s and 60s where there was rock and roll, Big Mama Thornton, Louis Jordan, who was the representation of early rap. He did what they called fast poetry at the time. And then you have Fats Domino. Rock and roll can be traced back to the 20s. However, a good portion of that is credited to Elvis Presley, who became famous in the 50s. We'll talk about that later. There was Little Richard, Chubby Checker, and rock and roll was a blend of blues and country rock. In the 60s and 70s, you had the immersion of soul with Aretha Franklin, Nina Simone, and Marvin Gaye, some of the very popular artists. From the 70s to the 80s, you had disco and funk, and those well-known bands were Earth, Wind & Fire, The Commodores, Kool & the Gang. The word funk comes from a Bantu word, low funk, that means strong odor. However, artists adopted this word to mean a strong feeling, like through the music. From the 80s to present, you have rap and hip-hop. Artists like Grandmaster Flash, Salt and Pepper, Run DMC, Pac, or Notorious B.I.G. Some little-known artists that weren't talked about are Rosetta Tharpe, who was famous for rock and roll in 1957. And Sylvester, who was the first openly gay disco star, known as the Queen of Disco from the 40s and the 50s. Blues was actually the foundation for jazz, rhythm and blues, R&B, rock and roll, and country music. Blues originated in the South. And like we said, it's from the 20s and 30s. However, white musicians did covers of these songs that were created in the 20s and 30s. 30 and 40 years after they were written, and they became famous off of these songs. EDM and house music evolved from disco. In the late 70s, Frankie Knuckles was spinning at gay-friendly clubs in Manhattan on the Upper West Side. House was short for warehouse, and it was mostly played in clubs in Chicago. In 1946, the song That's All Right, Mama, a Mississippi blues classic by Arthur Crudup, was stolen by Elvis Presley, sped up in 1954, and Presley obtained national fame for it. You also had Big Mama Thornton's song Hound Dog that was also stolen by Elvis Presley. You have country music that was strongly influenced by blacks in the rural South. It was a combination of blues and banjo. Banjo was originally an African instrument. Ray Charles is heralded by most as the OG country music artist. He was labeled one of the 100 most influential country artists in 94. And one of the first country albums to sell over 1 million records. In addition, there's opera dating back to Elizabeth Greenfield, Marie Williams, Matilda Cisretta, Joyner Jones. And then you also have reggae and gospel, which have a very strong African-American or black presence. A little known fact was that black people had to do what they called a chitlin circuit. The chitlin circuit was a black club circuit that allowed for entertainers who could not perform at white clubs to be able to perform their music. There's also the music genre punk rock, which you might not expect a lot of black people to be involved in. However, groups like Death, who performed proto-punk, which was punk rock before punk rock was punk rock. You have three black men, the Hackney Brothers, who started with R&B, and then that transitioned to rock and roll, which is what they considered themselves to be. So they were rock and roll pioneers. Then you have Bad Brains, which is one of the most influential rock bands, who were pioneers of hardcore rock with reggae foundations. And then there's Pure Health, Fishbone, the 1865, which was inspired by the Emancipation Proclamation in 1865. Now, I'm not claiming black people created punk rock, but nothing is more punk than being black. Punk rock is all about feeling targeted and outlawed. Black people had to actually book tours because clubs wouldn't let them play. That plays back into like the chitlin circuit and where black people weren't allowed to perform their own music and white people were becoming famous off of it. One black punk rock artist was talking about how he knows that a lot of white people enjoy punk rock, and after they are done with their punk rock phase, they take out their face piercings and take out their nose rings, etc., etc., and they're able to go out and get a corporate job. However, black people don't have that luxury because your very existence is defiance, and you can't necessarily decide, oh, this is just a phase, I'm going to stop being black now and go out and get a corporate job and assimilate into society, because your rebellion is what you wear every single day. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I hope it was informative, and the main purpose of this video was just to touch on the influence that black people have in the history of music, as well as shed light on the importance of music and music history. Music is just one of the many forms of art and expression where like music tells a story of what's going on during that time. Like when you look at Tupac, where he talks about his experience being black and how things don't seem like they're changing, and how that music still carries on to today and people can play the same music and get the same vibe. It shouldn't necessarily be that way, because there should have been at least a little bit of change since his time. But even when you think about the marches in Selma and what they were singing about, it's not very different to what's going on now. So music is a way to kind of string people that are very separate, very different, and give them this commonality. The same goes for music when it comes to love. Like I remember I was in fifth grade singing about getting my heart broken, never had a boyfriend, never been in a relationship, didn't even like boys yet, but I could still feel that music, and it still expressed any kind of melancholy, sadness, anger, aggression, anything like that that I was feeling at the time. So the arts are important, and it's very important to support artists, especially black artists, because they're very slept on. So go out, place your bids, help support the Black Arts Future Funds, as well as iDay. Thank you for taking the time out to listen to me, and have a great day. Okay, so if you watched this far, you deserve a treat. So here's the song that I was jamming to about heartbreak in fifth grade.
I know you hate me. I know I hurt you. But there's more. Listen. Watch this. It's to my confession. Just when I thought I said all I could say, my chick on the side said she got one on the way to my confession. Man, I'm thrown and I don't know what to do. I guess I gotta keep on to my confession. If I'm gonna tell it, then I gotta tell it all. Man, they cried when I got that phone call. I'm so gone, I don't know what to do but to keep on to my confession.
This gon' be the hardest thing I think I ever had to do.
Got me talking to myself, asking how I'm gon' tell you.
But that chick on part one, I told y'all I was creeping with, creeping with.
Said she's 3 months pregnant and she's keeping it.
First thing that came to mind was you.
Second thing was, how do I know if it's mine and is it true?
Third thing was me wishing that I never did what I did. How I ain't ready for no kid and my body running
late. My confession. Oh. When I thought I said all I could.